Thank you. Yeah, so my my presentation is going to be quick, short, and sweet, but it does have a lot of important information in here. And towards the end of it, that's when we'll look at least one of the developments that were put in the chat, maybe two. So stormwater preventative maintenance, what is it? We're going to go over what it is. We're going to look at some of the specific systems, and then I can give you some specific examples of, you know, what structures you should see and what you can do to keep your system functioning properly. We'll talk about invasive plant invasions just a little bit, and then putting algal blooms in your pond. So preventative maintenance, it helps keep your system in compliance and keeps it functional. So your system doesn't flood and protects your houses and everything else in your community. So it's basic maintenance. It's similar to your car. So, you know, you change the oil in your car, you make sure that your fluids are always at the right level, making sure that your turn signals work, everything like that, so that you're safe on the road and you're also not getting pulled over and getting a ticket for a headlight like that. So it's the same thing with stormwater. So we're going to look at the system as a whole and check the areas such as structures, inlets, outfalls, riprap, pipes, all of that stuff, just to make sure that they're functioning and not having issues. Things that are definitely required, especially around most of these structures, you have to have a 10-foot access area to be mowed, and that's for inspection purposes for the conservation districts or other delegated agencies. And also, if something minor needs to be done or some kind of fix needs to be done, they'll have access. There won't be big trees hiding it and preventing the maintenance to be done. Areas need to be free of vegetation. You know, they tend to gather some of the sediment that comes with the sheet flow around the inlets. And so sediment does build up in there, and you'll get some vegetation growing in there. So you want to keep those knocked down and out of that, out of the riprap areas, and also away from structures. If you have a tree growing next to an outlet structure or an inlet, it can cause some serious damage over time. And really, you know, that's where the big issue comes in. So if the preventative maintenance is overlooked, then that's when you start getting the bigger problems. And that's where the real money is going to start costing you to fix some of the bigger issues. Not to say the preventative maintenance going to prevent all big issues, but it should help and go a long way to make sure that you don't have that problem. Keep your structures unclogged. So make sure that any conveyance system in the stormwater part, outlets, inlets, everything like that, make sure they're clear of debris, trash, and animals. I can give you one example of a pond in Newcastle County that I had. It was constantly just way above what it should be on the permanent pool, and I just couldn't figure out what was clogging the outfall structure. And it turns out a turtle had lodged itself in the outlet pipe, and it was dead. So I literally had to break it apart in order to unclog that outfall. And it took a little while, but that pond eventually got back down to where it should be. And then, you know, fortunately, it was a big enough pond where I don't think there was any flooding issues, but it could have caused that over time. You know, organic debris, so leaves and other stuff like that that's washing into the ponds needs to be kept an eye on, and making sure that if it's clogging any of the conveyance systems in the stormwater management system as a whole, just keep them unclogged. And sediment is another one. So you'll see a lot of it, and I'll go over it a little bit more in detail, but you'll see a lot of the newer ponds have four bays, and they collect the sediment. So it's easier to remove the sediment out of your pond. You don't have to dredge the entire thing. You know, over time, the permanent pool gets less, and your storage gets less, because sediment, it doesn't seem like a lot, but over time, a lot of sediment washes into these systems. And then basic vegetation management, mowing at least once a year. Your riparian buffer keeps the woody vegetation down and does help with invasive plant species a little bit. Going over different types of stormwater management systems in some of the series: wet pond, dry pond, infiltration, swales. You heard about ditch systems here, and especially in Sussex County. And then we can talk a little bit about at-home stormwater management. So I want to use wet pond as the real example, the big example for preventative maintenance. So a wet pond is going to have a permanent pool. Oh, that's what most of you have. You know, it just looks like a pond that's been dug out, and it looks kind of like your mill ponds and things like that, except on a smaller level. But it's there for helping with stormwater management to contain the conveyance events all the way up to, most of the time they're designed to take care of a 100-year storm. But they're a little bit more dynamic than your drier systems. You know, you have to deal with water quality issues now. So, you know, a pond is supposed to collect the nutrient runoff, the sediment, the pollution. It's supposed to collect all these things. So you're going to have a little bit more issues making the pond look good and also keeping it functional. And, you know, algae is a big one, obviously. You know, a lot of folks have probably dealt with that over time. And that specifically is a nutrient issue. And we'll talk about that a little bit more in a bit. And then also public safety issues. So most of the stormwater ponds that you have now have a bench shelf. And that really is so if someone steps off the edge, they don't fall into a 10-foot deep pond. So this helps for safety. And you can also use that as an opportunity to plant those and you know, give some habitat and also prevent them from washing out. And then vegetative buffers. I can't stress this enough. Vegetative buffers do a lot for your stormwater pond as far as preventing geese from walking into your pond, capturing nutrients on the way in, stopping trash from blowing in, all different types of things for vegetative buffers, but they still need to be maintained and scouted on a regular basis to make sure that you don't have invasive plant species or woody species that get out of control there. So here's your standard design for a wet pond. If you look at the image on the left here, we'll focus on that one because it's not as fancy as the one on the right. But you can see here that you have inlets on this left side, and then you also have one right here. And that's where your drainage is coming from. It's coming in there, and it's coming into this forebay. So that's a pretty big forebay for a pond. I usually see them, they look a little smaller than that. But this here, it does a lot of the filtering. It captures the, and I'm sorry, you hear my dogs in the background, so I apologize for that. Give me just a second, please. Excuse me, I'm trying to work here.
So these are all great questions. Blake, as you're coming back in, two questions we have. Does a wet pond have a liner? And then the other one is, does a wet pond need a fountain?
Okay, so the first one, the wet ponds can have a liner. Most of them do not. You know, that they are using a liner is sometimes problematic, especially if you have a water table that shifts a lot. Because think about it, if you have a pond liner and then your water table comes way up, it's gonna push that liner up. So most of them are not lined, but there are a few. And then as far as does it need a fountain? It depends. You know, a lot of times moving the water around is good, especially if you're not getting a lot of flow. You know, it prevents, I'm not gonna say it prevents algae, but it helps decrease the amount of algae that grows because algae doesn't grow well in moving water. But also, you know, any fountains, whether it's a diffuser, which is usually, you know, pushing air from the bottom of the pond up, or a fountain where it's on top of the water and you see the pretty display. Both of those add dissolved oxygen to the system as well. So, I mean, that's always good to have extra dissolved oxygen, keeps things moving. And also, if you have fish or other things in the pond, it helps provide aeration. So normally it is good to have aeration in these ponds unless you have a reasonably good amount of flow consistently going through them. But at the end of the day, they're not required. That is additional maintenance. You know, you have to do preventative maintenance on those systems as well, making sure they continue to run properly. And they can get relatively expensive at times as well. But yes, it is good to have some movement of water in there. Is that another question?
Yeah, does there need to be a certain depth to the pond to have a fountain?
So the The fountains that sit on top of the water surface, as long as they're not sitting on the bottom per se, they usually have a float. You can use them in, you know, it doesn't have to have a specific depth. Now, if you're using diffused air, which is usually sits on the bottom of the pond, it's really not suggested to use them unless you have 6 foot or deeper water. And that depends on the system. So, but that's usually a good go-to number, because if it's too shallow, you're not getting enough, you're not going to get enough effect from that dissolved or diffused air to really make a big difference. So the on the surface fountains have a little bit more flexibility. All right, so the forebay, once it gets to a certain point, I think it's about, I don't remember the exact percentage, but when you start to see sediment build up pretty good in here, you want to keep it, you want to get rid of that sediment out of there, because eventually it'll fill up, and you know, you'd be surprised how quickly the sediment will fill up these forebays. Now, in wet ponds that don't have a forebay, you got to think that that sediment's going to wash directly in there, and it's going to get moved all over the pond. And eventually the pond bottom is going to move up, and you're going to have less of a permanent pool. And I've not actually been a part of having to dredge one of these ponds, but at a certain point, you know, you can't just continue to let the sediment build up, and then the functionality of the pond won't work. So we've been to the vegetative part of it. So a vegetative buffer should be all the way around there. It protects from sheet flow. It prevents erosion. It captures nutrients. Just a lot of benefit to having a vegetative buffer. And as far as geese are concerned, a good vegetative buffer will prevent them from walking in. Now you can't, it's not gonna get rid of all of them. Some of the residents will still pitch into the pond depending on how big it is. But it does help with the migratory population. And then you have your outfall structure here. They come in a wide variety of different structures, but just making sure that the water level is at where it's supposed to be. So if you're seeing the water level a little bit higher, most of the time it's because that structure has some trash or some debris or something like that in there. So that's a regular thing that you can do just to keep that clear and make sure it runs out. So then where your pond empties into is gonna come through a pipe, and usually will outlet into either a ditch, a branch, or some other conveyance system to move that water along. And now how these ponds are designed is it's normally supposed to be designed to not outlet water in more of a amount than before the construction was there. So it shouldn't, technically it should not stress that system too much. That's why, but you do have some outlet protection there. It's going to be riprap most of the time. And again, just check on that, make sure there's no vegetation in there, and make sure the water is getting out how it's supposed to.
So Blake, one of the questions that we have is, how often in years would you need to dredge a pond?
Again, since I've been working in the stormwater area for probably close to 15 years now, and I've never actually seen it have to be done. But, you know, we tell people to just have a plan for possibly 10 years. And then sometimes even, you know, most of the time it's going to be more than that. But if you have a forebay, you shouldn't have to dredge a pond. You should just be able to get rid of the sediment in the forebay.
Then another question is there a rule of thumb for sizing new ponds for development with the impervious surfaces?
I'm sure absolutely.
Taken into consideration during design.
Absolutely. The engineers, the smart guys, they're the ones that figure all that out. You know, there's a lot that goes into that. And then they still have to get approval from DENREC or the delegated agencies to make sure that that works right.
So another question is are records available? Like if you come into an HOA and you're not sure if it's been done before, where would they go to look for that type of information?
That's it. That's a good question. You know, it would probably be for permitting, because obviously if you're going to do some work like that, you'd have to have a permit. But, you know, I really don't know. I'm not sure if David will be able to answer that as well.
We'll ask him as well.
Yeah, we'll ask him that. But as far as, again, I haven't heard a lot of ponds needing to be dredged at this point. You know, because it takes a while for that sediment to build up. But it's always just something to have in the back of your mind. So what other issues come with permanent pools? So the water quality issues. So again, the nutrients that are being applied to either lawns or just, you know, regular sediment removal, you know, running off into the pond carries phosphorus with it. And algae growth is usually limited by phosphorus. So if you get someone to do a basic water test for you and you're showing any bit of phosphorus in your water, you're going to have possible issues with algae growth. So how do you prevent that? How do you do preventative maintenance for that? You know, ensuring having good vegetative buffers around there to prevent a lot more sediment from running off. You know, people, you know, taking care of their yards where they may, you know, maybe put some transition some turf into some other areas that don't wash out as much. You know, use rain barrels. We'll talk a little bit more about that. But don't ever underestimate the amount of effect that you can have by changing how your stormwater leaves your property. You know, if you have several hundred homes in your development, if each person, you know, takes steps, then that it definitely lessens the load on your system. And turbidity is another one. That's just suspended solids in the water column. And, you know, that comes from runoff as well. Normally you'll see turbid water after a rain event. And if it's something where you see it often, and that just, you know, just shows that you're getting a lot of sediment pushing into your pond, and you might want to find out why that is and where it's coming from. And dissolved oxygen. So anytime that you have growth of algae, you know, you're going to get, once it dies off and it starts to decay, it uses up the dissolved oxygen, especially at night, and that's when you'll see fish kills. Yeah, so again, cause of algae blooms is, you know, stagnant water. So that's where the fountains or the diffused air comes in, keeping the water moving. And some people will use just water movers. Maybe if you have a finger in your pond that just kind of stays stagnant, if you put some in there, it'll push it out. And algae just doesn't grow as well in flowing water. Shallow water. So a lot of algae species will grow on the bottom. So they actually start on the bottom and then they'll end up floating up to the top of the pond to continue their life cycle. You know, so if you have a shallower pond, you know, it's a good chance that, especially if you have a high nutrient load in there, you're going to get some algae. And you can see a high nutrient load and where that comes from. You know, runoff, fertilizer, goose, Canada geese, they can pump quite a bit of nutrients into your pond. And as I said before, phosphorus moves a lot of time with sediment. So that's the thing. Take the preventative maintenance with this regard is to take actions to reduce the amount of available nutrients. There is a way to precipitate phosphorus, especially if it's in your water column. There's a couple of products out there that will actually precipitate it and drop it to the bottom of the pond and make it unavailable. You know, I haven't found a lot of studies to see how long that phosphorus will stay unavailable. You know, obviously with natural processes and microbial activity on the bottom of the pond, you know, sometimes that phosphorus may become available again. And that's another way that phosphorus is available, is that it will come up from the sediment that has washed in over time. You know, removing the sediment from forebays is a huge help. The riparian buffers, bench shelf plantings that I talked about before, you know, with native beneficial plants will use up a lot of those nutrients, especially nitrogen, which nitrogen can also, you know, aid in algae growth. But, you know, a lot of times it moves so dynamically in a water system that phosphorus normally is the limiting agent. You know, winter organic removal, you know, if you have a big amount that stays in the water column, like on the bench shelf, like say you have cattails that are growing in there, getting that out will help. You know, with nutrients, because organic material holds a lot of nutrients. We call that in agriculture immobilization, where the nutrients are held up in, you know, say corn stalks or something. It's the same thing in ponds, but it stays in the organic material. Algae is another one. So, you know, it's really hard to physically remove algae, but that literally is the best way to remove nutrients from the system. Because if you chemically treat algae and it dies and it decays, it's releasing those nutrients back into the pond. It'll help. It still helps control it. But you're going to have to put something else in there to help remove those nutrients from the pond, or your algae is going to eventually grow back. Maybe not that this year, but the next year. Aeration. And then this is the at-home things I was talking about, rain gardens and rain barrels. You know, capturing the rainwater before it comes into the system. you know, is huge. And if you, like I said, if you extrapolate that over 100 people living or 100 homes in a development, that tends to add up pretty quickly. We've talked about sediment removal. And then the rest of these systems, it's easier to do preventative maintenance. So dry ponds, they do pretty much the same thing, but they have no permanent pool. The only difference is that, you know, they're going to remain dry for most of the time. They're going to be a little bit harder to plant. So if you want to plant your pond bottom, most likely planting a dry pond is probably not a good idea, unless there's something that can handle being completely dry and completely inundated for days at a time. So normally just kind of maintaining a grass buffer in the bottom of the dry pond is usually good. But keeping it mowed to the point where no invasive species or woody stems get in there. And here's the standard design. Again, most of the newer ones, probably all the newer ones you're gonna find are gonna have a forebay. And that collects the sediment, because the same thing happens in a dry pond without a forebay. Sediment over time ends up building up in there. And you know, eventually you might need to get it dipped out. Bioretention facilities, it's the same thing where it's going to be dry. There's no permanent pool. But it's a little bit more fancier, and it's going to be more expensive to put in. So if you see an area that's depressed, that has a lot of time there's mulch on top and some plantings in there, you might see some pipes that help drain it. But these systems are supposed to just do a better job of filtering out any pollutants and nutrients and move it into another part of the system as cleaner water. But again, the main things for this is making sure that any inlets and outlets are taken care of, and making sure that any, you know, unwanted woody stems and invasive species don't take hold. Vegetated channels, same thing here. You can see here that these are usually designed to move water more than control it and filter it. There is some filtering that happens, but you can see it captures the sheet flow off the pavement. This is kind of like a forebay where it collects some of the trash and debris and other things. So it needs to be cleaned out on a regular basis as well. And then again, making sure these channels stay to their design depth, you know, no accumulation of sediment or organic debris or anything else, preventing it from moving along. And she talked about tax ditches in the video, and I do want to look at the tax ditch map really shortly. But it is, as she said in the video, it's a really good thing to look at. Even if you don't need to know if it's a tax ditch or not, you can go on and use the LIDAR data, which I'll show you, and it kind of will give you an outline, an aerial outline of where your water is draining. It's pretty cool to look at. And then just I wanted to give you some information on where to look for how to control invasive species and things like that. So there's the Delaware Invasive Species Council. If you search them and find their website, you can go on and see what invasive species are prevalent and how to control them. I'm a part of the board for that council, and we're steadily updating the list we have and also the guidance for it. And then the Delaware Wetland Plant Field Guide. This plant field guide is good for identifying the invasive species, but it's also good for identifying some of the non-native invasive species as well. There's no control methods in there, but it just helps you kind of identify what you have. So then we talk about at-home stormwater management. I consider this preventative maintenance for your system, because any kind of thing that you can do to lessen the load on your community stormwater management systems will help it last longer and help not have to put as much money into the system. So rain barrels, you know, collecting, you know, I have two rain barrels around my house. I collect probably 50 gallons of water in each of them per rain event. You know, that adds up over time. And then when we're gonna use them, we're putting them in our, you know, you can use them to water your landscaping and your pots and things like that. So it slowly gets back into your yard to infiltrate better instead of just straight running off. And you can see how much water your property is delivering to the stormwater management system. Just go out during a rain event and you can see, like if you're seeing a lot of flow coming off of your yard, or, you know, maybe your gutters are unfortunately put right onto an impervious surface. So now you're pumping water directly into the system without any kind of filtration on your end. Yeah, it'll get filtered in the stormwater pond, but then that just adds to the stress on the system as a whole. You know, I talk about turf conversion. You know, I actually gave a presentation to the landscape industry and told them the same thing. But, you know, I also let them know that there's opportunity there. Just because you're converting away from turf doesn't mean that there's not opportunity to, you know, still manage meadows and trees and shrubs and other things like that. All of these help prevent major issues with stormwater. You know, and I talked about directing gutters away from impervious surface. And then you'll hear about pervious landscape or pervious surfaces. They're pretty expensive still, but as the technology gets better and more available, you may start seeing some things like this where, you know, there's pavement that's pervious and some other things. It's pretty interesting to look into. Here's an example of how a rain garden can look. I mean, this is a big rain garden. There's a lot of native species in there. You know, some people might think that looks wild. I think it looks great. And it's also helping decrease the amount of stormwater that's leaving whatever property this is on. And this is my backyard here on the left. You know, this is a rain barrel I have. I have two of them. And I pretty much use them on a regular basis to water my wife's fancy potted plants here that you can see. Here's some resources to look at. You know, the Division of Watershed Stewardship has a great stormwater management manual. Yeah, there might be some jargon in there, but there's a lot of good stuff that homeowners can take a look at and kind of figure out what they have, and preventative maintenance is described in there pretty well. And conservation districts, as you've heard from Sussex Conservation District, they're very active down here in Sussex County and will provide a lot of help for you. And as far as, I didn't have a ton of pictures, but if you go on to the Sussex County Conservation District, Jessica has quite a few, at least several good presentations on there with some really good pictures of what they've seen over there. So I definitely suggest taking a look at that. And there's private consultants in the area working on this type of thing. I can't really give you a list of that, but if you search for some private consultants, they actually do specialize in this type of work, especially with the preventative maintenance side of it as well. You know, so in summary for this is just preventative maintenance is necessary to keep your systems functional and in compliance. And if you're scouting regularly, you're going to see a problem before it becomes a big problem. Seeing some erosion happening around a pipe or something like that, you know, fixing the erosion before it washes out your entire pipe is going to save you a lot of money, and it's also going to keep your system functional. If you know a big storm is coming, or even a medium-sized storm, I would suggest going out, checking all your inflows and outfalls to make sure that they're flowing, because just, I mean, a simple, basic clogged outfall can cause major flooding issues during a storm. I've seen it down in close to the Forgotten Mile. I don't remember what those developments are back there, but I've seen quite a few times where they've had some major issues, and a lot of it was because of a clogged outfall system. I mean, there's sometimes you're just not going to be able to prevent flooding from happening just about the amount of water it receives, but the preventative maintenance will go a long way. And then again, at home stormwater management, just never underestimate the effect that you're having on the system with what you're doing at home. And that goes both ways. So if you have a lot of water leaving your property, and just doing a few things to help prevent that is huge, and it'll help in the long run. And so here's my information if you have questions. I'm always interested in doing this and coming out. And even though that we're trapped at home right now, we're still allowed to make some site visits. And if you need some site visits, let me know. And now next, I want to just really quickly go and look at what you would see from a tax ditch map. So here's the tax ditch map. See all of these purple polygons. Those are the amount of tax ditch watersheds we have, quite a few. And you can see it's really concentrated down in the southern part of the state. And as you move farther north, there's not as many. But still, a lot of drainage going on here. And you know, just a good map to look at. So I've put in the address to the senator's clubhouse. So that's all you have to do. In the top left here, you have an area where you can put your address in, even if it's your personal address. Hit this, press enter, and it takes you right to that. And unfortunately, I don't know what year the imagery is here, but there is an option. Let me move this out of the way here. But as you can see, it takes you to an aerial. It also has all of the tax parcels here too. So if you like wondering who owns this open space, you can check out real quick to see, you know, go to the county website and it'll tell you that after time, who owns this? So the Senators Homeowners Association. So now you know that this is, this area here is the responsibility of senators. That homeowners association needs to take care of these ponds. And so that's where it falls. And, you know, these are loose property lines here. So, you know, don't go on here and say, look, you're building stuff on my property based on this, but it's just a good reference point to kind of look at. So how do you look at your stormwater system as a whole? You go up here and this layer list will give you some options. So there's, you know, the road inventory is on here. You can see the name of the road. You got parcels. You can uncheck or check those anytime you want. But the thing I want you to notice is the LIDAR. So LIDAR is basically light sensing to give you elevations in the area. So it's kind of like sonar except with light. So you can see very quickly here that the purple areas are the low areas and the green areas are the higher ones. Again, this is, they're not 100%, but it's just good to be able to see, all right, so these stormwater ponds here, you know, what type of other systems do you have coming in here? And you can kind of see that this area is bumping off towards this way and flowing in here. You can see some ditching areas as well. So say this ditch right here. Say if you didn't know this ditch existed because it was way overgrown. Maybe you're wondering, why are we getting flooding in this area over here? Or why isn't this working? If you didn't know a ditch was here, this map will help you find that. Because just because there's trees in there, it's still going to show you that that elevation is lower. So you can see your ditch system. So it's just kind of good to just take a look, get an overview of what you have and where you are. I'll be perfectly honest with you. My wife and I are going to buy a new house in the next, I don't know, 10 to 20 years. But we're going to use this map to make sure that I'm not buying my house in a hole. So it's just a really good map to use. And it's good to kind of, you know, just get your bearings on what's there and, you know, where your ponds are and kind of where they end up. As you can see, all of these ponds are going to end up pretty much in this branch, or maybe some of it's going to go over here, but all that ends up running out. So it's pretty interesting to take a look at that. And, you know, again, here's an example. So real quick, here's a good example of how senators, you don't have tax ditches. These ditches that are running through your development, these ditches here are not tax ditches. So they are the responsibility of whoever owns that property. You know, you heard Jessica mention something about public ditches. There are public ditches, but there are a lot of private ditches, meaning that if you own a property and you're not living in a development and you have a ditch that runs through your property and it's not a tax ditch, that's your responsibility. And at the end of the day, there are help. There are places to go for help if you need to do any kind of major things to them. But that's kind of what Jessica was talking about earlier too, where, you know, there's no regulation. So if the landowner downstream is kind of blocking you up, there's nothing really that anybody can do to prevent them from doing so, unfortunately. You know, if they fill a ditch in or something like that, and they didn't have a permit or anything like that, there's some avenues there. But for the most part, unfortunately, you know, hopefully people are being good neighbors and letting the water flow how it needs to be. So that's really all I have. You know, if you guys have any questions right now, I can answer them. I don't want to take up any more time. But, you know, I'm always available to talk about this